Jackson wondered out loud there in Las Vegas about what her allegedly dysfunctional family was honoring. I spoke to her. You'll hear it. And Cindy Adams, our first studio guest, was in the crowd and backstage with the Jackson family, and we'll be hearing Cindy's inside take on all of what went on. Here's just a taste of Latoya. I'll bring you more later.
I really don't know what they're honoring, to be very honest with you. I don't understand the purpose of the reunion. Of course, it's been going on for now, I think nearly 2 years, actually. And now it just decided to just go off, and they decided to do it. It's been canceled and postponed a couple of times. However, I think the timing is wrong, and what they're honoring, I really don't know, because it seems as if you're kind of dedicating yourself and devoting yourself to something that you really don't believe in, if I were to go, which is child abuse, and I don't believe in that.
She said to me, and she said it directly to me, that what are they honoring here? Child molestation? We'll have much more, as I mentioned, with Latoya later, when we also look very closely at some of the other allegations now swirling around the head of her brother Michael. Now, these new allegations, as you've already heard, undoubtedly, we'll give you the inside scoop, include recent reports that other alleged molestation victims are now coming forward. We have two people here to talk about the truth or falsity of that. Ernie Rizzo, a private investigator, and of course Flo Anthony, our wonderful correspondent for the National Examiner. And in a totally different take on dangerous Mr. Michael Jackson, we will hear all about the various commercial controversies involving the King of Pop, including people over there. Chris, give me a shot of the group on the side there. People over there who claim that Michael has been robbing their songs and claiming that they are original. You'll hear the songs that these folks wrote. You can compare them in your mind with hits that Michael had and made tens of millions of dollars with. You can judge for yourself whether or not he robbed the songs. But right now, without further ado, with the inside scoop on that crazy non-concert honor show in Vegas, it aired around the world on NBC on Tuesday. Here is Cindy Adams from the New York Post and various television endeavors. Cindy, what was, to the extent that you can judge it, the state of mind of the Jackson clan? I'm talking about the parents and the siblings.
Euphoric, ecstatic, the fact that they finally actually got it together. They had been schlepping around with this for about 3 years. When it was set for last December, Michael then called from Switzerland, or wherever he was, we believe Switzerland, and he said, please postpone it until February. They had to get it all together again. They weren't sure that they could, but they did. And so they said, this is a wonderful, exciting time. That's what they said.
When Streisand played the same venue, every VIP in Hollywood turned out. How about this time?
There wasn't a good VIP representation except for Minister Farrakhan, and what can I tell you about him being one of the great representatives? But there was nothing from Sony, there was nothing from creative artists, there were none of the big famous stars that we would have expected. They jettisoned him, they let him go, and they did not support him.
Was there a feeling in the crowd that it was curious, to say the least, that here the family was honoring people of great achievement when in fact it had been branded as dysfunctional, and specifically that Michael had just settled this case for between $10 and $15 million?
The question I asked everyone, Dionne Warwick, Gladys Knight, Smokey Robinson, I asked them all, I said, what about the timing? Isn't this lousy timing? And everybody had their backs up with that one. The family said, it is never the wrong time to honor one's family.
I would like to believe in Michael, but the only question I have is, why did he settle? If he is innocent, why do this? Because the majority of the people who feel that he settled feel that's admission of guilt.
Because anybody who is a smart lawyer will have you settle any case today rather than going to court. If you bang in your fender, if you bang somebody's fender, they're going to say, look, settle. Don't make a big deal. Don't go with insurance claims. Because the process is very lengthy. It is forever. And you can only get killed in the process. By the time you're declared innocent, it's been 3 years of terrible headlines.
Ooh, I don't know if I agree with that, Cindy, because Michael Jackson has...
You're a lawyer. I'm not. The lady asked me.
Michael Jackson has made a point of going to court. He's made a point of going to court to vigorously defend himself when accused of stealing someone else's song, as we'll hear later in the broadcast.
That case was 20 minutes of duration.
It was.
He was accused, it was over, it was finished.
I really would like to know why the media finds it necessary to crucify a young, talented black man such as Michael to the extent that he's like found guilty, you know, like...
You think if he were white, it would be different?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. What
don't
do you
pick
think,
on me when it comes to the media. I have been defending Michael straight along. I choose to believe he was innocent, and I believe he was.
I want to know why Latoya Jackson is so...
I believe that he is somewhat dysfunctional. He is an oddity, and I think he was playing touchy-feely like kids do when they were growing up, because I think he's still a case of arrested child development. That's all I believe.
Well, I tend to agree with you, but unfortunately, the fact that it's arrested development doesn't make it any less a crime. The fact that he may be in an altered state of consciousness. But good.
I want to know why Latoya Jackson is so upset with the family now.
Okay. Now, you had a long talk with Latoya, as
yes.
I did.
I personally like Latoya.
Can you like them both?
Yeah, I can like them both. I like you and I like Sally Jesse Raphael. You know, what can I tell you?
She's got a point.
No, I like Latoya. Latoya is the most colorful, terrific, down-to-earth broad the world has ever known. She's got a mouth, unfortunately, that goes from here to Pennsylvania. And in Las Vegas, they were calling her, unfortunately, La Toilet. However, I think she is a nice lady. I like her. She's got some bug. The family has dumped on her. She is dumping on them. I wish she would shut her mouth. I think it's bad enough when the outside world picks on you. You don't need your own to pick on you. I would think that she should shut her mouth.
On that note, before I take your question, what I'd like to do is to show you now some more of what Latoya told me in our interview just over this weekend. Here's Latoya.
Michael has always gone to court for his songs, but it was never publicized. It was kept quiet. However, when it came to the Dangerous song, which he just won that battle, he was eagerly and ready to go there and fight because he knew that was his song. And he knew that he was going to win because he knew that he was innocent. But you must think, at the same time, why didn't he do that with He did say, after all, I will prove to you that I'm innocent, and I will show you. And he didn't. Cochran, who represents Michael, you've seen the attorney Cochran. Well, actually, he threatened my career. He said if I were to say anything else, he would make it a point that my career would be over immediately, and I wouldn't be able to work ever again in life.
What
Michael
career?
Will do anything at this point to free himself and make himself look good. I do know that he has bought his way a lot when I was at home with a lot of things, whatever he wanted, of course, money talks, of course, as we all know, and that's what he did with so many things and so many people to keep them quiet. And a lot of people won't come up and come forward because of this very reason. Now, as far as buying his freedom with a little boy, I don't know why he would think that he could do that and get away with it, when there are so many other people involved that will probably eventually come forward and speak. And I'm sure you will get one or two that's courageous enough to come forward and say something.
As you'll hear in just a couple of minutes, there are two more youngsters allegedly who have come forward. Let me get Cindy's comment on what she just saw before I take your question.
You can buy your way out with many things. You can buy your way out with emotion as well. She said to me that she tried to call her brother. Her brother did not return her call. You're talking about somebody, it's like a woman spurned. She's getting even. Whether she has right on her side or not, if she was so righteous, why didn't she say it before, years before? Why now, when the family has shown her that they don't like her attitudes? Why is she doing it now? It's not right to do it, Geraldo. It is not right.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, I would like to know, why doesn't the media say anything on the blackmail the father tried to do in the beginning of this?
I'm sorry, I didn't...
The blackmail. Remember the stories, the extortion,
yeah.
Where it became clear that the father, the producer slash dentist to the stars, was looking for the settlement that later was paid. Why isn't enough emphasis, I guess, going from that side, the greedy parental side?
Well, the point is that they quickly assessed what he wanted. If he wanted revenge, if he wanted righteous justice, if he wanted to protect his beloved child, or if he wanted money, they instantly assessed that money was what would put an end to that. Not revenge, not to have his child on the right path, not to get back for what they did to his child. He wanted bucks.
Any idea how many bucks Mr. Jackson has?
Well, he had enough to spend $3,000 last week in Las Vegas on books, and then he went shopping for CDs and spent another $3,000. So whatever money he gave the father, it hasn't dented his lifestyle any.
Cindy, you had said that many of the celebrities have withdrawn their support from Michael. Did you see any indication that Elizabeth Taylor had done that? And what is their relationship now?
Elizabeth Taylor has been staunchly supportive to such a degree that she turned the honors into a laudatory honor for him. And he had received an 8.5-minute standing ovation. And then when she was going on and on like this, they were saying, "Sing, Michael, sing." And she said, "No, he's not going to sing." And the audience started to boo.
And that moment, were you embarrassed for her, or do you think the audience righteous?
I think she should have quit while she was ahead. She should have done what she was going to do and then gotten off. She walked off and sort of semi-collapsed in the arms of Larry Fortensky, her current temporary husband. Elizabeth Taylor, Hilton Wilding, Todd Fisher, Burton Warner Fortensky. Has a nice ring to it.
Was Latoya on everyone's lips?
Latoya was on everyone's lips. Everybody spoke of Latoya. I spoke to her, and she told me, she said, "Don't think I'm going to stop. I have lots worse to say about my brother, and I'm going to say it."
Cindy Adams, ladies and gentlemen, has been our first guest. Now we will bring out our panelists, including the Private Eye, who claims inside information, Paul Anthony, and all those people who say they really wrote the song. Good, Bad, Dangerous, the trials and tribulations of Michael Jackson continue after this commercial message.
It's Magic's first annual rally.
Sexual molestation case, the original one, hired, I guess, by the biological dad, was it, Ernie? And how long did you actually work on the case?
A couple of months,
okay. Sitting next to him, someone who is a personal friend of the Jacksons, Flo Anthony. She's also friends, ironically, as is Cindy, not only with the Jackson families, but with the estranged daughter-sister, Latoya. Flo, you heard Cindy's take on the concert. Mm-hmm. Did you agree?
Not exactly, and everybody knows Cindy's my friend and mentor, and she sat in front of me during the concert, but her view must not have been the same as mine, because there were celebrities there, or maybe it's a bit of the generation gap, she didn't recognize some of them. John Singleton was there with Tyra, in fact, Bertice Berry, who was also there, and I got tired of watching them walk around. Prince Marky D was there, Michael Bivins was there, Nancy Wilson was there, and the reason that Minister Farrakhan did come, his son Wally Muhammad is Jermaine Jackson's best friend, so there's the connection that is there. So, there were probably celebs I even missed.
But you know something, you're a world observer, and I really credit you, and I am delighted that you're here, and you know that that concert was less than it should have been.
Not really, Geraldo. It depends on what you see. I like Dionne
Warwick. Michael didn't sing.
Okay, I mean, I would have loved to see Mike sing. I would have loved for a Jackson 5 medley. But I like Janet Jackson. I like Dionne
Warwick. She's terrific.
Warwick.
Janet's terrific.
I like Celine Dion, and I love Gladys Knight and Smokey Robinson. So I felt it was a great concert, and aside from that, Jermaine and Tito, the number that they did was magnificent. I was just glad to see Michael there being vibrant and alive and smiling and happy. And, you know, even though I think probably as much of Latoya as I do members of my own family, you know, the thing with who were they honoring, they were in the molestation, they were honoring Berry Gordy, who nobody ever told me he was a child molester, and Elizabeth Taylor, no one ever told me she was a child molester. They were not honoring each other or honoring Mike. So the honors, you know, were for the two of them.
Why is she still talking?
I don't know. I would never down Latoya. Latoya has been a very good friend to me.
Don't She's you think that the more she says, as loony as she seems, the truer it seems?
No, and I don't think that Latoya seems loony. I think that she just has her opinions on things and other people have their opinions on things.
It's not an opinion when you say your father molested you. That's not an opinion.
Well,
that's a statement of fact.
You know, I'm just saying that Latoya is Latoya, and I would never say that she's not telling the truth, because I believe that many things that she says are true. And as I've said before, I do agree that it's inappropriate behavior for a grown man to spend so much time around children, but he's never ever trusted adults. And in LJ, that's what I've always called Latoya, her behavior is one reason that he has never trusted adults. I mean, so...
Well, she's not even 2 years older than him. They're very close in age.
They're very close in age.
So. Now, Latoya told me that Mom said she could go to the concert if she signed a gag order.
They denied that. At the press conference, Mrs. Jackson said if they were going to put a gag order on Latoya, they would have done it a long time ago. You know, this
is just everybody
pitting so much against everybody. Geraldo, you know, it's very difficult to weed through this thing. I think what Jermaine wants is for Latoya to sit down and meet with the family, and I think they all need to do that behind closed doors. At one time, before she left with Jack, I mean, you know, she even says in her book and everything, all of them were extremely close. The first time I ever interviewed Jermaine, the first thing he said was the closest person he was to Latoya because of the closeness in their age, and Latoya says, yes, we were very good friends.
Is it scary to you when she says, I've just begun to fight?
I don't know if it's frightening to me. I don't know, even though I guess Ernie's about to tell us, I don't know how worse things can get. You know?
How much worse, really? Ernie Rizzo.
Yes.
I'm going to take a break, but I'm going to ask you one question.
Go ahead.
It is alleged that two youngsters have or are about to come forward to finger Michael Jackson as the accused molester.
That's right.
Only want a one-word answer. Is that true or false?
It's true.
We'll be right back. The trials and tribulations of Michael Jackson continue. Right after this.
Freshen your car with Glade clip-ons.
Clip on here. Clip on there. Clip on freshness everywhere.
Refills freshen for 30 days.
Clip on freshness everywhere.
Glade clip-ons, fresh from Glade.
A surprising thing happens to egg noodles when you take out the yolks and you add extra egg whites. They get lighter, fluffier, and there's no cholesterol. No yolks. We don't have what you don't want.
At the pond.
Open your mouth and close your eyes. Here comes a big surprise.
Mmm. Cereal. What is it?
Yes.
It's nice and weedy, and it's...
With Michael, the whole last summer, everybody saw him over in London. He just got off the tour when Michael came home, you know, right before Christmas. So, Ernie, don't you think it's just this little settlement that this other kid had just might have made them think, well, good, let us get a couple million, too. Why just be his friend?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Because that one kid changed the story.
Excuse me.
He and his
mother
are wrong.
Excuse me, sir.
Sure.
Was you there? Did you see it?
Of course I wasn't there.
Okay. Are these two kids getting paid?
Pardon me?
What, are these two kids getting paid?
Not yet, but they are trying. No. They are certainly
This is not about money. It's before a grand jury.
Oh, it is about money.
Yeah, but they getting paid, right? And you too, right?
Pardon me?
Okay. It's before the grand jury where? In Santa Barbara?
Santa Barbara.
Uh-huh. And what do you think, Ernie? Give us your, your learned opinion.
And it's hard arguing with fans. It's like arguing Elvis Presley's still alive. But there is no question what happened.
Flo, your comment on Ernie.
Yeah, my whole thing is that the one kid I don't know, the other kid I do know, you know, friends of mine saw him in London. He's been on tour with Michael for 2 years. He and his mother sat up there and gave praises to Michael to the sky. And now that this other kid's family has gotten some money, all of a sudden they're changing their story.
Why
and
not,
I just
Ernie?
Think
Why not?
That it's a total shame.
Would they risk perjury? Would they risk perjury before a grand jury?
Exactly. There's one thing about trying to go to bat for Michael. There's another thing about raising your right hand before a grand jury and going to jail for 5 years.
A lot of people commit perjury, and they're not going to put a teenager in jail.
Time out. When his parents came up there and his mother had to go before a grand jury, she told a whole different story why a Rolls Royce appeared in her driveway the very next morning after she caught her kid with Michael. So, it's a whole different story.
But she went on television then and lied for a Rolls Royce. What does that tell you? If that's even true. I mean, you're talking about some nickel and dime people. And that's Michael's mistake, playing with these commoners who don't know anything.
But Flo, you admit...
They're not commoners.
All right, well, I'll get into who they are social status-wise. But you admit, Flo, that it was an error As Latoya herself said in the previous segment, it is an error, was, for Michael to settle this case. All he did was open Pandora's box.
To settle it. I feel, as Cindy said, that he was just ready to go on with his own life. As I talked with Johnny Cochran while I was in Las Vegas, and he said rather than call it a settlement, we want to say the matter was resolved.
Sure.
I don't feel it was an error.
Sure.
I feel that he'll beat these people, too.
Yeah.
And these, you know, I feel he'll beat them.
Sure, he'll beat them. Every guy in a joint wants to put their problems behind him and pay some money if they could. They don't have Michael's money. That's not the problem. Michael should never have settled it because out there in the world, there are many people, many kids who know a story. And what's he going to do now? Fight the second one? Can't fight the second one. Because if he fights the second one, it admits the first one was right.
Well, you know,
so what's he going to do?
We'll wait until this comes out because, you know, I did something with Ernie a few weeks ago, and he told me Michael would be indicted by that Friday. In a whole few weeks or almost a month has passed, and I haven't seen any indictment.
Well, he settled.
So I don't know how good your information is.
Because he dropped $20 million to let it go away.
He did not. It was not $20
million. $20 million. Made it go away. Now, who pays that kind of money? Let it go away.
Let's ask this lady. Yes, ma'am.
No matter what, it's never going to be over. But also, why is just Latoya the only one speaking out in this big family here? I don't understand. Why is it just her? Is she getting paid?
I'll tell you
why. Tell you why.
Personally, because I don't believe just her. I don't believe the whole thing anyway. But why is it just her?
Well, let me say this. First of all, Latoya is kind of flaky.
True. Why isn't she getting backed up?
Latoya is kind of funny.
I think it has more to do with Jack than with Latoya.
Jack, her husband. Okay, hold it. Time out. Break.
Come on.
We'll come back. Let's bring out all those people who claim that Michael stole their songs. Might as well get the whole thing in play. The trials of Michael. Oh, yeah, they continue.
A lot of MCI customers confess they didn't get the savings they hoped for.
We tried MCI.
Speaking out is because she is the only one, Janet obviously accepted, Latoya is the only one who is truly independent financially, that all of the others, Tito, Marlon, Randy, Jermaine, etc., and the other sister, Rennie, is her?
Jackie and Reeve.
That they are all on Michael's payroll in one way or another.
Since I don't know anything about any of their bank accounts, I can't comment on that.
They get their checks
but
once
I
a month.
But I think that a lot of what Latoya does comes from Jack, her husband, who I once also liked until I defended her when he beat her up and he threatened me. And I was, you know, walking around with security myself. So
unusual.
Time,
such
I really, really liked him a lot.
Unusual
also.
Couple. They said on this stage that they'd never consummated their marriage. They said on the stage that they're going to get a divorce in a year or two.
She told me once she couldn't even imagine kissing him. So...
yeah, why is she marrying him? Very good question. Much more with Ernie and Flo, but right now let's get into this commercial dispute, this other aspect of Michael's life, one that he has litigated, spent lots of money on lawyers, and appeared in courts and done depositions, and has so far been universally successful. Did he really write all those songs, or did he pirate or plagiarize them? Crystal Cartier recently lost a $40 million lawsuit that she had brought against Mr. Jackson after Michael showed up at their trial in Denver and actually sang a couple of the bars of Dangerous for the jury. Now, Crystal, do you claim that you wrote Dangerous?
I did write Dangerous.
You wrote it in what year?
I wrote this song originally in 1985.
And Michael released it in 92?
91. November of 91.
Okay. What happened? Flo?
I just want to say my whole problem in Crystal's case is I understand that you never could find the original demo that you sent over to Epic or to Sony. And so I didn't even understand why he wasted time going to court with you with that.
Because it has nothing to do with the 19... You're talking about the January 88 recording. It has nothing to do with the October 90
recording.
But what
happened to you? Why don't you have a copy of a demo that you sent to a record company?
I have no problem with... I have my masters and everything is intact. All of my records are intact for the October 90 recording. That was over a year before Michael's album was released. All right? That's when my song was recorded. It was played over the air. It was played over the radio.
Let's hear Crystal Cartier's 1985 version of Dangerous. Now, they are...
Dangerous.
Now what I'd like you to do is rack up Michael Jackson's version of Dangerous, and we will compare. Let's go. My dangerous.
The girl is so dangerous. Where's the comparison?
Now, how many people see a similarity? Crystal, you believe that Michael dazzled the judge and jury?
Yes, he did.
And
he
how long did the jury deliberate?
3 hours.
Just 3 hours, and they threw your case out?
Exactly.
Okay. Do you remember when Michael was on the lam, as some feel, when he was moving around? In the midst of all the turmoil and controversy, he was doing his world tour and then suddenly was in Mexico being treated for an addiction to prescription drugs, I believe it was. Well, we have the videotaped deposition that Michael gave in Mexico on the next song or songs that he allegedly pirated. We'll play you not only the song, but also the deposition that he gave, and introduce you to four gentlemen who claim that he is indeed a thief. Again, they did not win. Again, they were left holding the legal bag. But let me take a break first, and we'll get much more into Michael the Pirate. Let me introduce an expert we have, an unbiased person in the room. Junior Vasquez is a music producer. He's worked with the likes of Madonna, Cher, Prince, many, many others. Lisa, Cindy Lauper. He's got all kinds of credits. Paul Abdul. Junior, I'm going to put them both together. I'm going to put Crystal's version and Michael's version, very short, together, and you tell us. They have the same title. Tell us if it's the same song. Roll it. Junior?
I believe there's a definite similarity there. The fact that it is not Michael that is singing her version, that's like you're distracted a bit with that. But I really think that there's a definite similarity there, and it's possible that she did say that they were playing, it was a record on the airwaves or whatever. These things soak into your head as a songwriter, I know that. I had things in my head since the 50s, 60s, whatever. I think there's a similarity. What bothers me, it's the same title.
Same title.
It's the same title.
What are the odds on that happening?
Similarity, and it's the same title.
Was there, Crystal, help us and try and be objective, and I know it's very difficult because you've lost this bitter lawsuit. Did the jury hear the issue of the title, and is there any doubt but that your Dangerous was released prior to Michael's Dangerous?
There's no doubt that mine was released before Michael's Dangerous, that it was played over the air before Michael's Dangerous. I hold the copyrights before Michael's Dangerous. And not only is the title similar, but the lyrics of the chorus are also very similar, including the rhyme.
Junior, you're definitely the judge and jury now. How do you rule?
My opinion is that someone in Michael's camp heard this song, yes.
Okay.
And it's, my opinion is...
All right. Took the jury just 3 hours to throw the case out. Crystal, how many did you sell? Michael sold 10 million or something.
I've got 1,000 floating around out there somewhere.
1,000?
Yeah.
Okay.
A whole 1,000.
In this videotaped deposition, Michael Jackson explains his songwriting technique. This is when he was in court fighting against my next guest. Let me introduce them. Raynard Jones, Robert Smith, and Fred Sanford. Okay. Oh, no. Fred was a separate case. So you wrote the same song these guys wrote?
One of the same songs.
Okay. Raynard and Robert. Here's what Michael said when they deposed him in Mexico.
Saw the words.
What were you doing there?
Creating what I heard at the time, French horns, which are soft horns, which I felt should have gone at the time in the beginning of the song.
It's Michael, and there is no doubt but that this man is a genius. But that's Michael explaining in that deposition his creative process, a very difficult job even for him. But again, Renard, what happened when you went to court?
Well, the jury never got a chance to review or look at all of the evidence. As it was, the judge's special verdict form was given to the jury, and one of the first questions that were given to the jury was worded in such a manner where the jury unanimously came to a conclusion that Michael had not taken our song, but it was worded in such a manner that they were asking, did Michael fully take our entire song? And that wasn't the issue. Michael took passages, several passages out of our song.
Did the Jackson camp ever offer to settle?
At one point they did, which was a very low settlement.
Wasn't it $100,000?
$100,000.
How much were you suing for?
$400 million.
And how long, Robert, how long did it take the jury to dismiss your claim?
I think it took them a very short period. But what happened is, at the end of the trial, after we went through 20 days, our experts had identified the highest degree of similarity, striking similarities. And what Michael had done was cut and paste. Songs are just like automobiles. You can steal an engine, a car, and if you have what they call access, well, you know you're not going to steal a guy's car up the street and then parade it right in front of him, so you have to disguise what you do better. And so what happened in court was that the judge really threw out total copyright law. Now America really has no copyright protection.
Are you appealing?
Our appeal will be filed next week.
Fred Sanford, not the guy from Sanford and Sons, but
I'm
this
alive.
Fred says that he sued Jackson over the song This Girl Is Mine. He didn't want the money. He wanted just to know how Jackson got a hold of his song. How do you think he got a hold of it?
Well, my tape was sent out by CBS Records after I had given it to them. They called and asked if they could send it out to Johnny Mathis, whose office was on the ninth floor of CBS Records. Also on the same floor of the same label was Wisner and Demand. And my tape was supposedly sent out March 11th, 1982. And the first time anybody heard Michael's song was March 29th, 18 days later. Mine's a duet, his is a duet, and I own the copyright by 6 months. So I'm definitely convinced. The most important part of my evidence was my tape, which CBS took and could never find after that. And the songs became the same.
Did you bring an action against him?
Yes.
And lost?
I lost the lawsuit, but the first vote was 4-2 in my favor. And the jury was out for 3 days and eventually came back.
Okay. Flo, comment on everything you've heard on the people who claim the songs are pirated?
I think that when you're in a position like Michael Jackson, it's the same thing that Junior was saying earlier. There's so many similarities, and when songwriters hear different things on the air and different notes go through their head, it's easy for someone to think something sounds like someone and for similarities to come up. I don't think that anything is definitive.
Fred's never it. Robert, never quickly, it. I gotta go.
One quick thing. I handed Michael the tape of my song in his hand after his father had asked me to deliver songs in Los Angeles for a duet album for Randy and Janet. And I included songs that I thought the Jacksons needed at that time because their record deal
was gambling. So they actually had your tape?
Oh, yes, I gave it to Michael in his hand.
Last guest, I have to introduce, I'm out of time, folks. Gordon Keith, he owned a studio where the Jacksons recorded their first record. He says that the Jacksons' business ethics are questionable. Quickly, Gordon, I'm going to give you one statement, then I got
to
go.
Okay, well, I'm here to back up the stories of Ray Nott and Bob Smith and Latoya, because most certainly the songs are theirs, and we in Gary have proof.
Gary, Indiana, where
right,
are you here?
We have proof to the pedophilia of Michael Jackson and the homosexuality of the Jackson family. So we have that proof. The only thing is that most people have bypassed us because media have not seen fit.
We'll hear
to
more
come
from Gordon in 2 minutes. Quickly, Gordon, I'm going to give you one statement, then I got
to
go.
Okay, well, I'm here to back up the stories of Ray Nott and Bob Smith and Latoya, because most certainly the songs are theirs, and we in Gary have proof.
Gary, Indiana,
right,
where are you here?
We have proof to the pedophilia of Michael Jackson and the homosexuality of the Jackson family. So we have that proof. The only thing is that most people have bypassed us because media have not seen fit.
We'll hear more
to come
from Gordon in 2 minutes.
For Latoya Jackson, sexual and physical abuse within her world-famous family was a personal tragedy. But when she went public with her story, it shocked millions. The image of America's first family of show business, an image that started with the success of the Jackson Five, was shattered. Latoya's parents continue to deny their daughter's allegations, but a private investigator found someone to corroborate them. He's a former Jackson 5 band member who also lived in the Jackson home. Today, for the first time, he supports Latoya's charges of abuse. And now, please welcome Latoya Jackson. I love you. You really did shock a lot of people when you talked about the verbal and physical abuse within your family. And what you're about to talk about is really even more shocking, because you say you were sexually abused by your father.
Yes, my sister and myself were both molested by my father.
When did it start?
Gosh, it started ever since I can remember, actually, with my sister, because she's so much older than I am, and we slept in the same bed. So I recall him getting in the bed with us and doing the acts with her. And my mother would say sometimes, "Joe, not tonight."
Your mother knew?
Oh, yes. My mother's very much aware of it. And then there were times when my sister couldn't take it anymore, and she would ask my mother to go get help for him, psychological help. And she refused to do that. And eventually my sister just decided that she wanted to leave home, that she could not deal with it anymore, so she left home.
You're talking about... Go ahead, I'm sorry.
That's my sister, Ruby.
Right.
And that's when he started sexually abusing me, when she left home.
But you were very young when it started.
Very young, yes.
And how long did it go on?
It went on for a couple of years. It went on basically my entire life. But of course, it went from that to verbal, if you know what I mean, which could be, it's so emotional as well, verbal, because the things are so terrible when you hear them say certain things to you, and when you're in a room alone together. And I didn't like that. That went on, that continued actually until I left home.
Verbal abuse can be even more devastating sometimes than physical, because it hurts. It leaves an impression,
yes,
in your head that doesn't go away.
But there was so much verbal. It was verbal in a sexual way, and just verbal in general, and also the physical abuse as well.
Tell us more about your mother's, conspiracy of silence about this? Did you ever talk to your mother about this?
Yes, I did. I spoke to my mother about it a couple of years ago when I couldn't take it anymore, and I asked her for help. I said, "Mother, I need help. Please help me. I just want to know one thing. Why is he doing this to me? Why did he do these things?" And she answered me by saying, "Yes, your father did these things. He was sick at the time, but you're not supposed to talk about it. You're not supposed to mention it, and don't you ever mention it again." And I called her again. I said, "But you don't understand. I need help. I need to know why. I need to know something. Please help me." Because you get to a point in your life where you can't cope anymore. You're thinking about it constantly. And I couldn't deal with it. And I kept reaching out for help, because she was my best friend. So I turned to her for help. And she wouldn't do anything about it. And she kept saying, "If you ever mention this to the public, I will deny it. And I will call you a liar, and they won't believe you."
You were very close to your mother. You were, you and Michael were the last to leave the family home.
Mm-hmm.
What did that say to you when she wouldn't help you?
It hurt me a great deal, because after all, she was my best friend. We did absolutely everything together. I mean, my brothers and people who were friends with the family would call me the shadow, because we were so much together. I was like her shadow. And when she turned on me in that way, it just hurt so badly. I didn't know what to do. I just said to myself, there must be other kids out there that are going through the same thing, and I need to reach out and try and help them get through this as well. Because it's a terrible experience. It leaves a scar for a lifetime.
Let me just ask you, because I had read a quote from your husband, manager, mm-hmm. Jay. He said you were repeatedly raped, and that you're a very sad woman because of it. Is that a fair...
Well, at a young age, my father engaged in that with me,
okay,
when I was much younger. As I got older, no, because he could go out and get any girl he wanted.
Right.
However, sexually, verbally, it continued. He would say terrible things to me. If we were alone in the room, "You know you want this, come over here and get it." Things like that he would say to me as I was older. But younger, children don't have a lobby, so we can't say no. But as an adult, we have a choice to say yes or no. But even as an adult, I couldn't say no when he said things like that, because my parents were so strict that we weren't allowed to really say no or anything. So I just had to listen to him talk to me like this, and I'll dare walk out the room. He'd grab me and beat me if I were to walk out the room while he's talking to me. So I just had to take these things from him.
You also probably still wanted his approval, which is what I've heard a lot of incest survivors say. No matter what he did to you, you still wanted him to love you.
Well, he was my father.